In the acclaimed movie The Thin Red Line, directed by Terrence Malick in 1998, a colonel of the United States Army named Gordon Tall and played by Nick Nolte forces his unit to conquer a small hill densely covered with vegetation during the so-called Guadalcanal campaign against the Empire of Japan. And against his captain's objections that the risk of losing, well, of losing the battle in this war is too high, the colonel breaks out angrily and he says the following words.
I've waited all my life for this. I've worked, slaved, eaten old, untold buckets of shit to have this opportunity. I don't intend to give it up now. You don't know what it feels like to be passed over. I mean, you're young. You're just out of the academy. You got your war. This is 15 years. This is my first war.
Soldiers who fear for their life try to argue the colonel out of this decision with cost-benefit calculations, but the excitement that the hill stands for proves to be stronger, at least in the eyes of this Gordon Tall. The hill, the colonel admits, is, at least so it appears, his hill, as if his personal life condenses into this catastrophic situation in which the hill's capture shall not be missed. Obviously, the colonel sees the embattled hill not exclusively as a strategic point of conquest in the fight against the Japanese, but as an individual bastion of his life. And as such, his rage exemplifies what Lacan calls jouissance, a painful enjoyment that transgresses the limits of what Sigmund Freud calls the pleasure principle. This concept of a painful enjoyment called jouissance was also already known to Sigmund Freud, because in his text Morning and Melancholia from 1970, he mentions, I quote, the self-tormenting, which is without doubt enjoyable. And in his later text Beyond the Pleasure Principle from 1920, he detects how a life-consuming enjoyment of trauma patients gives them, these patients, something more in return by not letting go of the situations of the traumatic accident. Now, in the following 30 minutes, I would like to try to clarify with Jacques Lacan what this kind of pleasure may have to do with ontology, that means the doctrine of the basic structures of reality. And I think this is insightful, since Lacan hints with his concept of jouissance to the fact that we human beings are sometimes pushed to risk the reality surrounding us from a position of radical negativity to somehow reboot our place in the society of which we are part, but also which imposes on us, the society, sometimes unbearable discomfort through laws, obligations, and intersubjective desires and fantasies. And also because of that, we have somehow to lash out against society, against the reality surrounding us, and somehow personalize and incorporate a point of negativity. And if this is true, then the insight into a certain form of acting out, incorporating negativity against the reality that surrounds us, may have the property or the possibility to give us a new somehow sense of life, and probably, especially when we experience it as miserable, as Colonel Tall does in this very famous movie. So when this life somehow appears to be threatened by failure, but also when it appears to be threatened by too much perfection. I published the central arguments of my talk in an article that was projected here with the title Jouissance as an Ontological Factor, and I will present my findings here on a smaller scale, so not with all the with all the conceptual details that I present in the article. It appears as if Colonel Gordon Tall's life has the chance to somehow be granted consistency after a long and painful period of submission, and the colonel says so explicitly in the face of his confused captain. And as such, for a moment, he embodies a trait that Lacan describes as paranoia, and I quote, for contrary to the normal subject for whom reality is always in the right place, the psychotic subject is certain of something which is at issue, ranging from hallucination to interpretation, regards him, reality isn't at issue, certainty is. And indeed, that's my point with my reference to the movie The Thin Red Line, the colonel, for him, there is something certain. There is a certainty at stake regarding this battle. Suddenly, his miserable life has the chance to experience a form of absolution from another dimension of reality. Arbitrary life stages are about to fall into a totality that suddenly makes sense to Tall. All that has to be done is to put everything in jeopardy, so such that everything that can be risked becomes, at the moment of a potential failure, what it may already be, actually nothing. Prevented enjoyment of a badly treated soldier who has not had a chance to get his share. In situations like these, Jouissance confronts us here with the form of the colonel's excessive desire as a traumatic element, a core of intensity which contradicts moderation, because somehow he has to risk his life and he has to risk the life of a soldier to somehow get back into contact with reality. Jacques Lacan follows Freud and speaks in the course of his development of the concept jouissance specifically of surplus enjoyment, a paradoxical pleasure that involves a certain type of suffering and pain with violent consequences that threaten the mind and the body. Jouissance, he says, can be a path toward death, since without transgression there is no access to jouissance. And Jacques Alain Miller's often quoted essay with the title Six Paradigms of Jouissance, Lacan's oeuvre, is a helpful elaboration of the concept's development from the early seminars to the later ones. And I will refer to this article by Jacques Alain Miller times and again. Miller shows the ways in which at different stages of Lacan's work, Lacan links jouissance to his so-called three registers, the symbolic, the imaginary, and the real, into which subjectivity is, literally speaking, libidinally and normatively woven into, like into a threefold cord. And in that sense, Miller underlines that jouissance can be narcissistic, or can have somehow a narcissistic dimension, as captured in an imaginary dyad of the ego and alter ego, but it can be symbolic as insofar as jouissance emanates from demand, and it can touch upon the real as that which cannot be represented. And the last case is especially interesting for us, at least for this talk, since here, with jouissance and Lacan's concept of the real intertwined, the human being enjoys at the cost of his or her well-being. And absurd as this may sound, but exactly this is what then this enjoyment is all about, that it risks the well-being of the individual. In a famous lecture called Psychoanalysis and Medicine, Lacan writes the following. He writes, "What I call jouissance, in the sense of which the body experiences itself, is always in the nature of attention, of a forcing, of a spending, even of an exploit. Unquestionably, jouissance starts at the moment when pain begins to appear, and we know that it is only at this level of pain that a whole dimension of the organism, which would otherwise remain veiled, can be experienced." End of quote. As such, and somehow this is the thesis that I would like to present, as such, Lacan's concept jouissance marks the both painful and joyful disturbance of a mind's libidinal equilibrium, which also gives coherence to the basic structure of reality from the point of view of the individual. Because someone can live a fulfilling life and be happy at all levels of what modern society has to offer, and yet he may or she may not resist a very specific form of jouissance, to risk all in favor of a small and obscene deviation from the ordinary, may this be through a WhatsApp message to a minor showing oneself half naked, through cocaine use or a photo of a preteen Thai girl which is hidden in a drawer. The life of the individual becomes condensed as symbolic in confrontation with this minor and sinful deviation from the conventional. As I mentioned, it might be the nude photo from Thailand, the drugs, etc., which paradoxically is effective only by being potentially capable of destroying the symbolic universe of the individual. the seemingly slight deviation or slight irritation may influence as traumatic and as overly intense encounter with an other the subject's ability to accept the full ontological weight of her or his world experience. And Lacan's notion of jouissance helps us understand this kind of transgression, which an individual might have to risk as a reenactment of what Lacan calls the forced choice of subjectivity. And this is somehow the thesis put in a nutshell, and I hope that I will that I arrive at explaining what I mean here in these very dense sentences. To demonstrate what jouissance as an ontological factor can mean, I will explain my argument with regard to two examples, or more precisely with regard to two individuals, one taken, as already mentioned, from the work of fiction, the already mentioned movie The Thin Red Line, and the second example is taken from a political scandal which took part, which took place in the 2010s. Here I refer to Anthony Weiner's obscene enjoyment of a picture exchange with an underage girl. Both individuals, so Gordon Tall in the movie and Anthony Weiner, are interesting since the colonel in the movie finds an unconditional ground of his existence in risking his life and the life of others in a senseless uphill battle. And the case of Weiner is interesting since the former politician of the Democratic Party annihilated his political career by sending explicit photos of himself half naked to a minor, and I try to rationalize with Lacan the behavior of the two individuals as paradigmatic examples that exemplify jouissance as an ontological factor. I have to admit, though, that the examples I present here are somehow arbitrary. So I have to ask you to give me in advance what Donald Davidson calls the principle of charity, i.e. a charitable understanding of my talk, of what I'm trying to aim at. I defend my choice of the two individuals because their examples are just, at least from my argument, somehow so clear. Insofar as they are supposed to illustrate a universal experience everybody of us, I think, is somehow familiar with. It is the experience that subjectivity is time and again pushed to reshape its relation to reality by putting everything through the subject itself at risk. The behaviors of the two personalities I'm interested in exemplify a traumatic and overly intense encounter of an other within their symbolic worlds, an other which gives the individuals the ability to accept the full ontological weight of their world experience. A structure of agency comes to light through which, in a single moment, the subject's situation within its social framework can dramatically shift. In other words, again, to express it a little bit more in a more simplistic way, in other words, this talk tries theoretically to demonstrate how people in general may sometimes be pushed to reenact through an obscene, painful, and joyful transgression, their own genealogy of submission within the process of civilization by suspending the normative and evaluative use value of what in generally is understood from Aristotle onwards as the good life. Sending half-nude self-portraits to a minor, this is the case of Weiner, or starting a military operation with excessive casualties, this is the case of Captain Tall, dialectically changes the lives of the subjects in a way that mirrors Lacan's fascination with jouissance as an ontological factor. It lays bare what subjectivity in its core is about. It is somehow always and time again a limit of the world or a limit towards the world. As such, jouissance does not so much express Lacan's Hegelian conviction that subject and object mediate themselves through time, but that subjects must try, in order to relate to objects, to cut the very relations that tie them to others in order to regain or rediscover their singularity of being, and also from there on to rediscover anew somehow their relation to reality and what reality is about. Situations of acting out can exclude individuals from the social group, And obviously this happens in all in these both cases. And then questions are important to attack or to tackle. Questions like, what has pushed them to go that far? Which forces are accountable for apparently catastrophic results? And then these are the kind of questions that I would like to focus on. And in that sense, the talk hopefully shows that through entering the social world, or to say it with Lacan, to enter the chains of signifier, the subject is forced to accept normative restrictions, and this involves the sacrifice of its pre-symbolic enjoyment, which then might strike back. In the form of jouissance, it breaks through in violent moments and seeks to re-establish a new order of being, one in which both the rules and the specific jouissance of the subject get their share. This, at least in a nutshell, is what I would like to explain in more detail in the rest of this talk. Okay. So let's go back once again to the movie The Thin Red Line. As I already said, the Colonel Tall of the United States Army, forces his unit to conquer a small hill densely covered with vegetation. And against his captain's objections that the risk of being defeated, the colonel breaks out angrily and expresses these astonishing words. I've waited all my life for this. I've worked, I've slaved, I've eaten untold buckets of shit to get this opportunity, and I'm not passing it up now. What's interesting, obviously, is the first sentence, I have waited all my life for this. So how can he even say that, to have been waiting all his life for an apparently very, very dangerous uphill battle? But obviously, somehow this can be understood. Somehow the colonel sees the embattled hill not as a strategic point, but as an individual bastion of his life, to give his life, and that's why the entire scene is fascinating, to give his life, which is apparently experienced by himself as miserable, a certain form of coherence. And that's why the soldier he's in conversation with, and where he expresses his desires, totally astonished about these words. How can somebody be so keen entering a battle and mirror the entire battle onto his own subjective perspective of what the narrative of his life is supposed to be about? In that sense, one could say that this hill becomes what Lacan calls das Ding, the thing. Very abstract, but I will explain this later on in more detail, to which I will come back later. So don't be disappointed if the following graphic, made by Frederic de Portere in a very nice article, remains for now enigmatic. It will get clearer later on. But somehow this is what I would like to explain, that Gordon Tall is somehow striving for something. He wants to touch something that somehow sacrifices, or gives, no, not sacrifices, that somehow gives a sublime dimension to his miserable life. In that sense, he wants to touch, in the vocabulary of Lacan, what is beyond reality, the thing that somehow gives him a new source of sense in his miserable life. The thing is somehow an enigmatic concept, which Lacan picks up from Sigmund Freud and combines it indirectly with Immanuel Kant's concept of the thing in itself. The Kantian thing in itself stands for the backside of our phenomenal reality, which we can only refer to indirectly. Also, we can only refer to the thing in itself indirectly through somehow the veil of the phenomenological reality surrounding us. But since this world is always too close to us, as well as always too much, and in that sense out of reach for us, it is always more than the world of our experience, and in that sense Kant's concept of the thing in itself tries to express this, that reality is always smaller, the reality surrounding us is always smaller than what's truly out there, and in the reality as it is, somehow not accessible for us human beings. And this is what the thing in itself stands for. It is the other in what is for us real, but an other that we never can get a grasp on, at least conceptually. But nevertheless, this thing in itself somehow is also hidden in the phenomenological world surrounding us. So we desire to get at it. We desire to get at reality as close as possible, to really have a fulfilling life. And how could this be else when we somehow get to what reality is all about and not only what phenomena appearances are about. In the words of Jacques Alain Miller, one could say, what is meant by das Ding, the thing? It means that satisfaction, the truth, the drive, the Befriedigung, is found neither in the imaginary or the symbolic, so these two registers that are central for Lacan, you could say, let's say, could neither be found in the realm of phenomena, and they might be also socially depicted through the symbolic or imaginatively depicted through my personal fantasy. I continue the quote. It, the thing, is outside what is symbolized. It's of the order of the real, so it's something that cannot be depicted, but it must be there because our reality is always smaller than all the parts that are in there. Or to say it in less abstract words, the thing in this understanding functions as a melancholy object of loss that can never be incorporated by the subject, since this loss of this thing, is an a priori condition of subjectivity. And this is what this graphic is supposed to show, but I will come back to this graphic once more later on. Yet it, the thing, must be fantasized as lost, since a subject who is not forever plagued by the experience of having been robbed of its substance would not be a subject at all. So we are always somehow entrapped in this loss for which this thing stands for. And it appears that Gordon Tall wants exactly this, at least in this very famous scene. He wants to reach out to something that is beyond the order of the signifier, beyond the realm of experience, as if this hill or this uphill battle could grant his miserable and unimportant life some kind of consistency, some kind of divine meaning and sublation. Everything, if he captures this hill, somehow can be reintegrated, for him at least, in the order of a meaningful world. And in that sense, he has to capture this hill. One could also say that something in Colonel Tall has failed to be expressed in the order of the signifier, let's say in the order of collective meaning, and that the situation of life-threatening stress he finds himself in is a way out of this impasse of at whatever cost. And as I said, this is astonishing, or it is somehow absurd, because he is not only risking his life for his personal battle, but he is also risking the life of his fellow soldiers, and only somehow to get his enjoyment, to get something out of, to get in contact with a reality that somehow reintegrates his miserable life in the broader in a broader narrative of meaning. So while on this account desire operates according to Lacan's so-called three registers, the symbolic, the imaginary, the real, via the imaginary and the symbolic as some kind of barrier against that which cannot be represented, Lacan calls exactly this what cannot be represented the real. It is somehow, in that sense, always contaminated by jouissance as the driving force to hit out against the other registers, the registers of the imaginary and the symbolic. As I already said at the beginning of my talk, arbitrary life stages are about to fall into a coherent order that suddenly makes sense for Colonel Tall. All that has to be done is to put everything in jeopardy, such that everything that can be risked becomes, at the moment of a potential failure, and this is important, what it may actually be, actually nothing, or prevented enjoyment of a badly treated soldier who has not had a chance to get his share from life. Or from meaning. Jouissance confronts us here within the form of Colonel's excessive desire as a traumatic element, a core of intensity which stands in opposition to moderation. In this respect, one could state as a first conclusion that one property of Lacan's concept of jouissance is to underline that for us human beings, the world, in its common sense understanding of everyday life, is not supposed to be experienced as coherent. And obviously this is irritating, because you would say, well, that's, we desire coherence. How can it be that we somehow want to question coherence time and again? So if this is true, then this insight into a certain form of incoherence or desire for incoherence has the paradoxical quality of sanctioning our lives, and especially where we find it both miserable and threatened by failure, as well as suffocated by too much perfection and harmony. This may explain why Lacan interprets jouissance from the 1960s onwards as a form of moral masochism, a concept, a term that he borrows from Freud, and he asserts with regard to Kant and the moral law in Kant's work that, I quote, "If one eliminates from morality every element of sentiments, if one removes or invalidates all guidance to be found in sentiments, then in the final analysis, the Sadian, the Sadian world is conceived," so the world of Marquis de Sade, "as one of the possible forms of the world governed by a radical ethics, by the Kantian ethics as elaborated in 1788, end of quote. Lacan's reference to Kant's moral law is of importance here, as it is actually, and probably you know this when you have studied a little bit Kantian ethics, as it is actually a law out of reach for humans. It is a law of an anticipated inaccessibility that carries an infinite desire, especially in comparisons, for example, with ethics of Aristotle. This moral law that has to be subjectivized, according to Kant, carries an infinite and an excessive demand that we never can somehow reach or attain. But exactly through this, the moral law which Kant speaks of can be a paradoxical inspiration of restlessness, an existential electricity that serves the subject even in situations when it's risked its own life or the well-being of a community. And somehow we have this example in the movie The Thin Red Line. In as much as Gordon Tall is also confronted with some kind of an excessive demand of himself, something he truly cannot really catch up with. It is worth mentioning that this kind of jouissance is uncovered by Lacan also within Teresa of Avila's spiritual writings, because he calls them, I quote, "mystical ejaculations, which are neither idle chatter nor empty verbiage," end of quote. Lacan speaks of a jouissance beyond the phallos, that means beyond an order of coherent meaning, and somehow this order is unable to restrict and to delimit the mystical words that Teresa of Avila is somehow sending into the world. A similar example to Colonel Tall's excessive enjoyment that carries a pleasure and pain economy beyond the good life, the so-called Aristotelian good life, can be elaborated upon through the tragi-comical fate of the American politician Anthony Weiner, and maybe you remember the scandal that he provoked. The Democrat ruined his career and that of his wife, who was one of Hillary Clinton's closest advisors between 2015 and 2017, by repeatedly sending a photo of himself with a bath towel around his waist to a minor girl via his mobile phone. The published pictures of Wiener's were amusing to a wide audience, as in one of the photos, Wiener literally grabs himself by his name as in Wiener Würstchen. Curiously, however, it was not so much the fact of his behavior, but rather that he was caught again in a similar pose several months after the first scandal calmed down. And somehow this second scandal then truly ended his career. Now my admittedly speculative thesis, which again, as I said, asks for a maximally charitable reading, is that Wiener, as in the case of Colonel Tall, had to act as he did against all odds of cost-benefit calculations. He had to do so since his world experience might have received within his mind its ontological consistency only through a constitutive violation of the symbolic order and his role within it, touching the circles of a potential president, namely Hillary Clinton. The violation of the pleasure principle, which aims as a principle of suffering at a place out of place, keeps us in this world, as Lacan says. And again, you see the impact of jouissance, a desire somehow to transgress all a carpet of norms, through then somehow get in contact with its own role in normativity frameworks. So we live, allegedly, to destabilize living. Since life would be unbearable without its other, this life-threatening counterpart. And somehow jouissance is the fuel we our mind is running on exactly to get into this dialectic, to transgress the law and our relation to the law, to then fall back into the law and again to live within it and to find my place in it. Since Lacan understands from his seminar 7 onwards jouissance as an ethical principle, which is not the same as being a principle within ethics, his distance to Aristotle and the peculiar pleasure and desire administration within the Aristotelian understanding of the good life could not be more extreme. Bear in mind that Aristotle, at the beginning of book 6 of his Nicomachean Ethics, is interested in defining his concept of right desire as a necessary condition for successful practical thinking and moral excellence, and also practical handling or doing, agency, practical agency. Aristotle writes, here you have the quote, "Moral virtue is a state of character concerned with choice, and choice is deliberate desire. Therefore, both the reasoning must be true and the desire right, if the choice is to be good, and the latter must pursue just what the former asserts," end of quote. The enjoyment of, for example, buying a house is not supposed to carry us away beyond the limits of reasons. So right desire, obviously, and you see hopefully already the distance to Lacan and the excessive desire of enjoyment. Right desire is restricted by practical reasoning. It needs limits to arrive at a level of true satisfaction and true enjoyment which helps the individual to flourish. In that sense, right desire fits our basic enjoyments as needs that are features of the human nature, obviously. In this sense, the notion of a good choice for the right action is truly objective insofar as it is grounded in facts about the world, including facts about my place in this world, and in facts about what constitutes human flourishing. And obviously, in this light of argument, the choices made by Gordon Tall and Anthony Weiner are not good since they lack the right desire. Taking Aristotle's word into account, it is no wonder that perfect enjoyment, again you could say perfect jouissance, is personified in God as the unmoved mover. One can find it as well, according to Jonathan Lear, in True Contemplation. This explains in part why Aristotle questions repeatedly the sophists in his ethics as they present themselves as the enemies of true rest, promulgating in contrast to rest and being unmoved, a false and vain understanding of enjoyment for enjoyment's sakes, for enjoyment's sake through truth relative talk. This Aristotelian understanding of the right desire stands in distance to the Kantian moral law that we mentioned earlier. Anthony Weiner's life world may have concentrated into an experience of libidinal intensity in the moment when the mentioned photo was sent, an intensity that no longer knows any pleasure principle in its ordinary form of right desire. From this intensity, which is experienced with sexual relish, the individual may suspect that he or she can no longer catch up with the coming catastrophe and yet cannot refuse the command of her desire or his desire to send the photo. We find here jouissance in its purest form as a minimal ontological inconsistency injected into a seemingly homeostatic basic structure of being by something that Lucretius and Epicurus call a slight deviation, triggered in the case of Anthony Weiner by the send button, pushing the send button. But as I said, this kind of behavior can be better understood if we link it as a counter-reaction to what Lacan calls the forced choice of becoming a subject in the first place. And his concept of forced choice is what I would like to explain in more detail. The concept forced choice refers us to the process of civilization everybody of us has to endure to experience him or herself as a subject among subjects and objects. But this is a painstaking process, especially for children, as everybody probably knows who raises children. Education is subjectivation time and again, and for Lacan, similar to a sacrificial situation where something has to be sacrificed. And what has to be sacrificed? Well, Lacan calls it, metaphorically speaking, a pre-symbolic life substance of enjoyment. Think again of the thing already mentioned that has to be given up as it paradoxically emerges with the development of the symbolic order as the individual's other side of self-reflexivity. So somehow what has to be given up only becomes apparent as something lost when we have traversed the process of education. To put it less abstractly, when we are subjectivized in the process of all kinds of educations from our early childhood days to our later days, we have the impression of being robbed of something that is experienced by us as loss only looking back from our place in society, from our individual point of being already somehow educated and subjectivized with regard to all kinds of loss. Every myth concerned with a lost paradise or state of nature exemplifies this loss of enjoyment and of pleasure, which as lost is only seen from the state of culture, so retrospectively. This kind of sacrificial situation is constitutive and in the context of various social contract theories concerns the incorporation of the subject into the administered form of communal enjoyment and communal reasons. Because, as you know, we cannot always enjoy as we wish, but we are limited in our enjoyment, especially in democratic societies. The subject, who is supposed to choose freely his or her community, let's say that much, for only a free choice is morally binding, does not exist before this choice. It is constituted by it. In that sense, the choice is paradoxical. It does so only if it has already made the right decision of subordination to the pre-existing social contract of the community. Because if I choose the other, if I choose not to choose, if I choose not to enter society and to become a subject, then I risk the freedom to lose the choice myself. Clinically speaking, I choose psychosis. Sacrificed is, so according to Lacan's theory of the act of choice, that which he calls, with reference both to Kant as well as to Heidegger and Freud, the thing which we already mentioned. It is the incestuous object in which an impossible enjoyment is allegedly embodied as it is fantasized. Striving for impossible enjoyment becomes our fundamental task, nevertheless. It leads to the fact that we all participate in what Freud calls Kulturarbeit in its various forms. Kulturarbeit is then a compensation for the unreachable surplus enjoyment of pleasure that, annoyingly, remains always at a radical distance and apparently out of reach. And it has, of course, to be out of reach because only an impossible object can be the source of proof that there is more in the subject than the subject itself. And Lacan expresses this idea, among others, in his text on the graph of desire. To give an example, the primitive organism of a toddler, here in the image on the right side of the graph, has to become a split subject in the context of the mentioned forced choice. It has to plunge into the symbolic order, the order of the signifier, so that in the end, after his education and his subjectivation, a small vegetative organism of a toddler emerges actually as, for example, Prince William, Duke of Cambridge, with all his insignia transmitted to him by the House of Windsor. Here we can see how an organism sacrifices a pre-symbolic life substance of enjoyment to not only play a prince's role, but to enjoy the symptoms of a prince as one's own. So it starts out on the right side below, and then somehow this organism of a toddler has to enter the order of the signifier here marked with a red arrow. Let's say this is the order of the signifier of the House of Windsor. And what is the effect? Well, the outcome is, as it is supposed to be, we have a Prince William, Duke of Cambridge, who is not only playing to be a prince and a duke, but who actually has all the symptoms of a duke and probably all the also the correct unconscious of what it is to be a duke. The American neo-pragmatist, this is just a side note, Robert Brandom, describes these processes of sacrifice analogously in his theory of inferentialism. So this is obviously nothing new, but Lacan describes it, but he describes it with his own vocabulary. But it's, there are many theories about subjectivation and education, obviously. But this somehow is Robert Brandom's answer, and because he also describes how sapient beings, also beings equipped with speech and reason, how sapient beings are trained so long as their sentience properties, let's say their animal properties, are subordinated to the right moves in a game of what Robert Brandom calls scorekeeping of giving and asking for reasons in a coherent field of communal experience. This process, though, has antinomic dimensions, so it has also some problems, because these problems stand out when one tries to pin down the mentioned competence with a certain date or a certain age or a final exam. So there's some kind of uncertainty principle with regard to, well, when can we truly say that somebody has entered now, let's say, as good as possible this game of scorekeeping. In other words, the human being always comes too late to his or her correct moves in this field of scorekeeping, and obviously this is also unsettling. The threshold between the place where we are trained as moral beings and the place where we are autonomous in our moral behavior, playing properly the game of giving and asking for reasons, is, as I mentioned, surrounded by a principle of uncertainty, which again plays into the condition of being forced to choose one's character, that's a Kant quote, one's life and one's morality. Here another quote of Lacan, desire is a relation of being to lack. This lack is the lack of being. This lack is beyond anything which can represent it. With Lacan, therefore, one could say that the subject will retrospectively open up the order of the signifier, which is the order of what Lacan calls the big other. Let's say in Kantian terms, it might be also the moral law. According to the subjectivation thesis of the graph of desire, as the individual itself is unconsciously posited by the big other, but also the individual somehow posits the big other, the order of the signifier itself, as a precondition of being a subject. And after all, this means what the concept forced choice stands for. In doing so, self-images obviously play a role. Think of the fate of Prince William, Duke of Cambridge again. Obviously, he has an image of himself with regards to the calls of the House of Windsor. But this self-image puts a primary bifurcation, a split into the totality of the organism's libidal energies, because you could never, also Prince William, Duke of Cambridge, cannot be truly sure that his unconscious is also willing to subordinate itself to the order of the signifier. There's also always more in the Prince William, Duke of Cambridge than let's say, the symbolic role of Prince William. There's more in Prince William than even Prince William knows what there is. One result is that the unity of the self-image must, according to Lacan, always be inadequate to the abundance of desires, not only the desires, let's say, of the House of Windsor, but also the desires that waggle on and inexist and continue to exist in our pre-symbolized bodies, so really the biological fabric of our symbolic roles, which in turn are the recrements of our symbolic bodies. So you can see that obviously there's a split, because you have a biological body and then you have a symbolic order, and the biological body will be incorporated so that we have at the end subjects. But there's always something left over. You could say, well, the symbolic order never gets closed down or becomes a totality. but neither the individual, because there might be something in the biological fabric of this body that is not adaptable to the symbolic demands. And again, you see here how forced choice can have a normative pressure on the individual's psyche, which then in return somehow can lead individuals to these situations that I've been focusing on in the first half of my talk, this kind of acting out situations as experienced by the figure Gordon Tall and the politician Anthony Weiner. There's always a desire left over, not taken care of within the rise of the image I am and I relate to. For example, being a prince in the framework of the House of Windsor. It is desires like these that pop up in the lives of Colonel Tall and Anthony Weiner and somehow want to have their say. The forced choice, so, can never be put to rest. It lingers on in self-reflexivity, causing lustful pain in the ego's self-relation with that which, coming from the unconscious, it is not. The individual is not. And interestingly, we see this right now in the media that another prince of the royal family, Harry, known symbolically as Duke of Sussex, makes headlines since he's trying somehow to escape this symbolic role and to recalibrate probably also his unconscious desires. Tall and Weiner, so let's come back to these two figures. Tall and Weiner exemplify subjectivity's dependence on jouissance as an ontological factor with regard to forced choices. They grab on, speculatively thinking, to this forced choice, which is always in the making. But now somehow to transform this forced choice in their choice through an act of acting out or slashing out against the demands. The untold buckets of shit that Colonel Tall talks about are supposed to be transubstantiated into surplus enjoyment, whatever the cost of life may be. The goal then is somehow a transcendental fantasy, the re-establishment of Tall's or of Weiner's sufficient reason for their surplus enjoyment deprived existence. The mind higher order, the mind's higher order abilities may truly have forgotten what, let's say, the mind of Weiner and Tall had to choose in the process of entering into and establishing a frame of certainty. But this does not mean that unconscious parts of their psyche, as in the case of Harry, share the imposed process of forgetting choosing. So in that sense, there might be unconscious parts who have not adapted to the forced choice. In that sense, one could say that an anti-Platonic anamnesis sets in with consequences that crisscross everything that the Platonic understanding of anamnesis stands for, so the remembering of eternal forms. So we have here some kind of an anti-Platonic force of remembrance, because it's another form of remembrance. It's rather suppressed desires that want to be remembered and want to remember through the body. So we are here not confronted with clearly defined universals in the classical understanding of Platonic anamnesis, but we are here confronted with forces of a netherworld within the ego and its communal dysfunctioning. Those parts of the psyche that resisted forced choices can continue to inexist in the mentioned form of a lustful pain and pleasure disturbance that is both troubling as well as electrifying for the mind. For the same reason, we can sometimes be terrified and amazed by our dreams, but also by our actions, exemplified above by Colonel Tall and Anthony Weiner. What do these actions stand for? Well, they might stand for an unconscious objection to the forced choice by an apparently minor deviation, an irritative act that nevertheless can criss out my symbolic role, but nevertheless I have to make this act to put everything at risk so that I can relate myself to what I have had to endure. In this sense, I understand jouissance first, in accordance with many scholars in the field of Lacanian philosophy and psychoanalysis, as a painful lust in the psyche's libidinal economy, and especially what Jacques Alain Miller calls impossible jouissance, or sees as at the center of one of Lacan's most famous concept of jouissance, captures a paradoxical and ultimately necessary obscene operation of our mind, as I mentioned, to transgress certain legal and homeostatic forms of the internalized symbolic norms to which our psyche in its self-relation had to submit. Subsequently, however, I understand jouissance second as an enigmatic desire of vengeance that tries to reenact the forced choice that the individual experience had to endure, and how, well, through what I would call acts of abjection, a term that was coined by Julia Kristeva. The mind, the individual mind, feels not only the lustful urge to transgress normative limits, to slash out against the investiture of the self, but it wants to repeat the forced choice through abjection, though this time from an allegedly empowered position that gives the individual a proper option, whether it may cost her or his life or the life of others. If Colonel Talz or Anthony Weiner's superego could speak in the situations that I'm interested in, it might say the following. Disrupt for a fraction of a second everyday life and all its normative burdens that you depend on. Now everything depends on you. Or show what no one else is allowed to see. Expose your desire in its purest form to all symbolic claims against you. Or with regard to the graphic that I showed earlier, touch the thing, touch what you had to sacrifice to be in this miserable or so-called perfect life that is yours. Lacan detects similar kinds of enjoyment beyond pleasure, not only in, as I mentioned, Teresa of Avila's mystical words, but also in the sublime personality of Antigone. But these examples, Teresa of Avila and Antigone, of some kind of unrestrained enjoyment, prominently commented on by Lacan in Seminar 7, and subsequently also by many Lacanian scholars, they often compel us to overlook too quickly that jouissance does not have to favor sublime ideas, as it is the case in Antigone, but even, as I said, obscene and even horrific ones as well, let's say the death of others or child pornography. Weiner followed speculatively thinking an unconscious command to be irrational and not irrational, to risk everything for nothing, because, as I said, he did it again, encore. Jouissance is included in the pleasure principle, but does not belong to this principle, you could say. It is an excess that cannot be seen even as excess because its scale falls into its own form detached from any norm. In that sense, jouissance marks a form out of form, and it, as such, it is also somehow at least indirectly reflected upon by Kant in his understanding of the moral law. This is also a form out of form. In jouissance-charged actions like these, the psyche recovers parts of the disciplinary costs passed on to him or her by the big other. The psyche seeks to retrieve the credit imposed on itself, which is only possible if a cost and benefit calculation in the symbolic libidinal household of the individual is rejected completely. Think again of Weiner's fate. I do not want to deny that a pathological addiction to sexual arousal may have driven the man, but I think sexuality as an effect can just be one of many variables in a complex equation that can have strong ontological components with unacknowledged desires beneath the ego's reasons. Incidentally, Lacan sees such an act of freedom in the work of Marquis de Sade, and he writes, Marquis de Sade does not want to create lust or eroticism, but, as Lacan says, he wants to approach the reader to a burning center or an absolute zero. Sade's work belongs to the order of what I shall call experimental literature. The work of art, in this case, is an experiment that through its actions cuts the subject loose from his psychosocial moorings, or to be more precise, from all psychosocial appreciation of the sublimation involved, end of quote. Terrence Malick's title of his movie, The Thin Red Line, evokes, as the title says, a line. This thin red line has an outstanding property, one could say, since it can be seen only when it has been violated or crossed. The line literally separates human reasons from jouissance. Its relation to the Lacanian thing does not exist as a boundary between, on the one hand, rationality, and on the other hand, jouissance and temper. Rather, the reference to the line's thinness means more, namely, that we cannot make it out. It becomes visible only looking back, or let's say it becomes visible only too late. The director Terrence Malick underlines this insight in an important scene in the last part of the movie. We see here Colonel Tall in a sitting posture of exhausted contemplation, almost reminiscent of Albrecht Dürer's Angel in Melancholia. The battle has been fought successfully, although with high losses of American lives. Corpses and battle debris lie around like senseless props with an expired meaning. And this is also the case as depicted by Dürer's Angel. Did Colonel Tall really had to go that far? I think that's probably the atmosphere that this scene wants to transmit. You could say, of course, since the red line can be measured only through looking back, all the circumstances are somehow clear now that jouissance has come to an end. Tall is sad, but obviously satisfied mentally and bodily. The battle gave his miserable life an ontological contact with reality. This may underline Lacan's insight that subjectivity must time and time again, as I said, make the experience of madness, of transgression, in order to step out of itself and into the corset of the symbolic order anew. Indeed, jouissance is then the painful libidinal fuel that is requisite within the mind in order to go that far. It is the only substance that psychoanalysis claims to exist. Substances are immutable bearers of change according to the classical definition, as I understand Lacan here. In that sense, substance, jouissance remains always the same. Jouissance belongs to the basic structure of reality, since it remains the same basic feature in the subject-object dichotomy in all possible worlds. The German philosopher Hegel has given an ingenious formulation of this power of jouissance as, let's say, negativity's driving force for spirit that knows no dependency on the pleasure principle as well. In the preface to the Phenomenology of Spirit, he famously writes sentences that could have been well cited as a voiceover to Colonel Tall's contemplative silence, and here they are. And I truly, please allow me if I put them as a voiceover to Colonel Tall's scene when he somehow contemplates the end of his jouissance. Death, if that is what we want to call this non-actuality, is of all things the most dreadful. And to hold fast what is dead requires the greatest strength. But the life of spirit is not the life that shrinks from death and keeps itself untouched by devastation, but rather is the life that endures it and maintains itself in it. Spirit only wins its truth by finding its feet within its absolute disruption. This tarrying with the negative is the magical power that converts it into being. The colonel did not know where the red line between jouissance and reason was hiding. He discovered it as an unconscious desire looking back after trying to touch upon the thing as the sufficient cause of reality. The colonel had to carry out his act because the symbolic order at its core carries even these insane formations at its origin. And jouissance repeatedly draws us back to the source of a forced choice, which we are called then upon to reset. The The battle is an encounter with the real, with that which cannot somehow be represented. But there is no need for a colonel Tall to know what this, the real in this Lacanian sense is. Similarly, for a politician, a priest, or an actor, a nude photo of a minor girl or boy may be such an encounter with the real. The lustful real presence can extinguish the symbolic order with force because it is able to make the world coherent. In other words, when I'm confronted with this lustful presence of utmost danger of my own symbolic role, I experience pleasure because I can allegedly renegotiate the social contract that has been done unto me. This much, should you still be there and listening to this talk, thanks for your patience and your attention.